Okay, so I gave this one this like catchy title, like from redox reactions to batteries, but really that's actually what we're going to do. We're going to be looking at how chemical reactions can be turned into batteries. And I normally do this in class, and you can look at it on like an overhead projector kind of thing. And that's why it says a demo electron energy is released as heat. And when you do a redox reaction, oftentimes there's heat associated, especially spontaneous redox reactions. They'll generate heat. You can feel the reaction vessel get warm as you do a redox reaction. The example that we're going to look at is not the one I normally do. I normally do what's called a Daniell cell, but this is a really neat little video we're going to watch. And this is the reference to the video, but we're going to look at copper. And we're going to look at the single displacement reaction of silver ion from solution, or the single displacement of copper from the solid by silver ions in the solution. So this is a spontaneous reaction, and we'll talk about how we know it's spontaneous by doing calculations, but it's clearly going to be spontaneous in this reaction. And before we start the video, I want to make sure I reference this is North Carolina School of Science and Medicine. And what we're going to be looking at is the redox reaction between copper and silver nitrate. It's known as a single displacement reaction. You may remember that from chemistry, like 3A or high school chem. But anyways, here's the reaction. I'll explain what's going on. As you're looking at this, I'll pause it periodically. This is a microscopic view. So this is a piece of copper wire, and unfortunately the lighting's not very good. And this is silver nitrate, just a droplet. And they're inserting the copper wire into the silver nitrate solution. You can already see something going on over here. So these are actually silver crystals growing, these fine needle-like crystals. You can kind of see the color here, and you can see the copper wire, and hopefully you can see this in the background. In the background, what we're doing is we're starting to see a little bit of blue. And it turns out copper 2 plus ion, aqueous copper ion, is blue in solution. So these are really neat. I mean, super fine copper crystals. All right, so that was a spontaneous redox reaction. You probably would not have felt the heat from that one, simply because it's so small. But in fact, if you had done it on a larger scale, you could have felt the beaker and you would have felt the heat. So what this means is this is a spontaneous reaction. And one of the things we talked about in spontaneous reactions is that they have usable energy. That is, we should be able to capture that energy if we could just somehow figure out how to harness the electrons. And so this is why I kind of call it the electron circus. Like if you had fleas, right, and you wanted fleas to do work for you, well, you could just have them jump up and down all over the place. Or you could make them put a little tightrope up, right? So here's a little tower, right, on one end, a little tower on the other, and string a little wire across there. And then your little fleas, and I actually don't, plan my drawings that well. And now you can tell. You can get a little flea to walk across the wire by putting a little food over here, maybe. And then if you really want to get the work out of him, right, you could somehow harness something to him so he's pulling something always in one direction, and you can get your flea circus, right, to like do like your work for you, your evil bidding, let's say. Anyways, hopefully that's not your aspiration. For one, it's not very effective. But how do we do it in an electrochemical reaction? So really what's going on is I have a solution, and ignore the picture on the right. We're just looking at the picture on the left for now. We have a solution where we have copper, and the silver ions in solution from silver nitrate are depositing on the copper. Now, when they're doing that, they need electrons to do that. This is a redox reaction. Electrons have to be transferred to the silver as it comes on. Well, that means there needs to be a source of silver. Now, the reaction overall is spontaneous. It has a negative free energy or positive total entropy, however you want to say it. But when the copper ions come off the metal, in order to go into solution, they actually have to dump electrons off. Every copper atom that leaves the surface dumps off two electrons, and those are the electrons that are coming to the surface and reacting with silver atoms, ions, to form silver atoms on the surface. So what you're actually seeing in that process is you're seeing the solution turning blue because of the copper was essentially dissolving into the solution, and then that you were seeing the silver crystals, those needle-like crystals, growing off the surface. So there's energy in that process, and if we could capture this energy of the electrons, then we'd be all set. This is what actually a battery is, right? So the way this works is we just separate the two. And typically this would be a silver wire, and this is copper in copper solution. So what we do is we do this. We put a beaker around the copper, and we put a beaker around the silver, and in the beaker around the silver wire, right, we make this silver nitrate. So we'll just say AgNO3, but it's silver ion. So we've separated the two reactions from each other. And then what happens is when this copper wants to leave this wire, it needs to give the electrons to something. And so what we do is we just connect it literally like the flea circus. We connect those two with a wire. Now the electrons can leave the copper metal surface. The copper atoms can leave the surface as copper 2 plus ions. And then the electrons can go around through a wire attached to the silver wire on this side. Now, it didn't have to be silver. It turns out it could have been any metal, really, to do this. And then we have silver ions in solution that deposit onto the surface, and then you see silver ion growth. So basically, we just separated these two compartments, and this allows us to harness the power that goes through the wire to do our evil bidding for us, let's say. Not your flea circus. That would probably not work. Now, there's only one problem to this whole setup right now. If one ion even is formed, right, it creates a positive charge in this solution. There's enough electrical potential to stop the reaction at some point when you get enough of these ions, because there's no way to balance the charge in this solution. You're creating ions and you're sending the negative charge through a wire. There's no way to balance that charge in the solution, so the reaction will effectively stop. So the way we allow this to continue to work is we create a bridge of ions. Usually this is a high concentration of a salt like KNO3, very soluble ionic compound at a high concentration. So what happens is when the copper ions move like this, then the positive charge buildup in the solution can be alleviated by potassium ions going this way, or nitrate ions going this way. And we choose this ionic compound to be something that's sort of not going to mess up our reaction. This is known as an electrolyte, and this is known as a salt bridge, because it's basically a bridge between these two reaction vessels that allows charge to be neutralized both on the copper side and on the silver side. Okay. Now, side note, these things all have names, and I'll teach you those names on the next diagram. But in essence, we separate the half reactions. You notice this is the copper half reaction for this reaction, and this is the silver half reaction. It's silver ion to silver for the same reaction. So basically, we can separate the half reactions into their own containers because we can connect them and transfer the electrons through a wire. And this energy can be used to do, like run a flashlight or a laptop. It is actually how all batteries are, or at least traditional batteries, have been created in the past. Now, let's take a look at a traditional electrochemical cell. This is known as a Daniell cell. And what the Daniell cell uses is a zinc electrode on one side and then a copper electrode on the other side. And in the standard cell, standard meaning the same, like the thermodynamic standard, this is 1 molar CuNO3. And this is 1 molar Zn, and sometimes it's sulfates, but usually ZnNO3 like this. And again, under thermodynamic conditions, standard state means 1 molar, right? And then inside of this internal connection, this is known as the salt bridge. And it usually contains a high concentration of some ionic compound in solution. Again, potassium nitrate is a pretty innocuous choice. Usually it's one that's used often. Now, the electrons are coming from the zinc electrode, and the zinc ions are going into solution. So this electrode actually constantly gets smaller and lighter. And its electrons come around an electrical circuit. And go into the copper electrode. And then what ends up happening is this electrode constantly gets larger. Now that the electrodes, because it's picking up copper ions from solution. Now the electrodes, based on whether or not there's oxidation or reduction going on, have different names. So the half cell where oxidation takes place is known as the anode. And the reaction where reduction is taking place is called the cathode. Now, the cell that contains the zinc and the cell that contains the copper as a whole, they have this general name called half cells. So these are known as this is the zinc half cell. And then we have the copper half cell. The overall collection of the two half cells is known as a cell. So this is the Daniell cell because of this whole contraption is called the cell because I have half the cell here and half the cell here. Now, the zinc half cell contains the zinc half reaction and the copper half cell contains the copper half reaction. So we have half cells, we have an anode, we have a cathode, we have a salt bridge, right? We have the direction of the electron flow is from the anode to the cathode for a spontaneous reaction. So electrons are going this way, right, for spontaneous. Now, if you wanted the electrons to go the other way, then it would be a non-spontaneous cell, and you would have to put energy into it in order to get the reaction to take place. And that's actually a later part of our whole lecture for this chapter.